Thank you. Well, hello there. You know, it's time for a Christmas story. Let me just get my...
Once upon a time, on Christmas Eve in 1942, during a holiday party at the Livingstone Manor in New Orleans, the crashing noise, followed by a loud thud, occurring on the floor one story above her, was so ear-piercing that when Detective Chief Inspector (DCI) Sheila Watson looked up, she felt as though she could see through the high-arched ceiling beams with X-ray vision so clearly that with her eyes she could somehow hear the last breath escape from the one that she would soon find out fell to their death above her. DCI Sheila Watson of Scotland Yard was not exactly comfortable wearing a formal dress and a fascinator with more feathers in it than when a male peacock is courting a female, though it felt like a very small price to pay for the once-in-a-lifetime chance to be chosen by her longtime friend, Dr. Nigel Livingstone, as his traveling companion to his discovered secret location of the Fountain of Youth. Though now, after running up one side of the grand arching banister stairway, seeing her loyal friend Dr. Livingstone lying face down on the floor with pools of blood and drowning the white fluff of the Santa hat that he had put on earlier this evening for the jolly event, caused her to briefly lose her own breath. Blood slowly yet steadily started to circle and saturate the bizarre set of all the objects lying around the face down Dr. Livingstone. A wrench, a lead pipe, a revolver, a dagger, and now a very crimson-colored rope. Dr. Livingstone, a world-renowned explorer who spent his life traveling the globe, discovered tons of valuable artifacts at his adventures. He was also secretly searching the world for the Fountain of Youth. His family estate, the Livingstone Manor, was castle-like. A large, multi-domer grand dame with turrets on all eight of his corners of the four-story lavish home. His family had settled in New Orleans along the Mississippi River in the French Quarter. After Dr. Livingstone discovered what he believed to be the Fountain of Youth, in an undisclosed secret location, he declared it to be, quote, the discovery of a lifetime. The doctor decided he would be one lifetime, right? Am I right? He decided that he would like to have a travel companion accompany him on an annual trek to the secret location. It was known that Dr. Livingstone would be announcing who his travel companion would be at his hosted holiday party, where he would serve a traditional Réveillon dinner at his historic estate. The wealthy adventurer host had sent out invitations to a mysterious list of guests that he met along his global travels. Hopefully one of them is an editor. Though none of the guests were allies. Probably was an editor. They were invited to attend the joyous holiday party via secret messenger and were all informed that the lucky recipient head was to be announced at the party. Though the invitation explicitly noted that there would be no sharing of the location of the Fountain of Youth. Inspector Watson met Dr. Livingstone while on security detail at the National Museum in 1922 when he was sharing his valuable discoveries. For as differently as they lived their lives, they were both fascinated by each other and swapped adventure stories for hours. They have, or rather have had, been loyal friends ever since. In that moment, seeing her own reflection in all the blood at her feet, she realized that a shadowy figure was just opposite the hall, scrambling out of sight right when she reached the top of the opulent staircase. Before discovering the doctor's tragic fate, quickly gathering her wits, she ran to the extravagant fireplace, tracking bloody footsteps with every swift step, and lunged towards the mantel. There, resting upon was an Italian brass and bronze elephant antique clock with a brass clown holding an umbrella on top. decadent. She yanked down and on the clown and her brow like a giant lever, shattering the protective glass face of the clock. At once, there was the sound of what seemed like a jet plane taking off, followed by the combinations of jackhammering cacophony of sounds, a bang, relentless clicking, bizarre whirring, and finally a clang. DCI Watson knew of Dr. Livingston's security lockdown mechanism for his estate, hidden every brass elephant clock clown with an umbrella on all six fireplaces throughout the house. She had just activated the panic room mechanism that Dr. Livingstone built outside of his home to secure himself and his prized global expedition findings within his estate. Every window, door, secret exit, now had a steel barrier clenched down upon it. No one was getting in or out of Livingstone Manor until DCI Watson figured out who did this, and it was going to be a very long night, especially in her uncomfortable party gown. The detective inspector managed to round up every party attendee and house staff member into a billiard room. She politely requested that they all keep watch over each other while she would interview each person in the library on the other side of the estate, strategically out of the earshot of any guilty eavesdroppers. And then...
Take 1812, action.
DCI Sheila Watson grabbed her first suspect. It was Dolores Finkel, the eccentric heiress who never left home without at least half of a dozen of her favorite daggers from her extensive dagger collection. DCI Watson opened the grand pocket doors that guarded the ornate library, teeming with rare books from all over the world, and gestured for Dolores to enter. Dolores sashayed past DCI Watson, fluffed out the back of her ball gown like a peacock showing off her fancy plumage, gingerly sat down on a dark leather chaise near intricately carved writing desk, snapped open her gold cigarette case and delicately placed a cigarette in a long cigarette holder that she held lazily between her lips. She looked in DCI Watson's direction with sultry bedroom eyes. It was a look she was accustomed to giving men while she waited for them to rush over and light her cigarette. DCI Watson didn't acknowledge the sexy stare or the unlit cigarette, and instead clotted past Dolores in her uncomfortable high heels, placed both hands heavily on the writing desk, leaned forward and said, "Dolores, do you know why I brought you here this evening?" A look of boredom washed over her features as Dolores half rolled her eyes, plucked the cigarette holder with the unlit cigarette from her pouty lips, and said in a dry tone, "Dr. Livingston, I presume..." Annoyed with Dolores' tone, DCI Watson snapped, "Livingston is dead." For a split second, DCI Watson thought she saw a mixture of fear and worry pass behind Dolores' eyes. "That's right, Livingston is dead, murdered, and a dagger was found by his body." "Your dagger was found by his body," shouted DCI Watson, pointing her fingers at Dolores. "How dare you," Dolores shrieked. "I would never let one of my babies be part of a murder." "Prove it," challenged DCI Watson. "We all know you carry at least six daggers with you at all times. Show me that you have all six with you now." "Never," cried Dolores as she stood up and suddenly to make her way to the door. "You want to see my babies? You can call my lawyer." Dejected, but knowing Dolores wouldn't get far since the mansion was locked down, DCI Watson went to the library door to gather her next suspect. Before she could get to the door, James Nighthammer burst into the room. He was pacing rapidly, his head and hands shaking as he pulled at his clothes and hair. "Look, I know Livingston is dead," he stammered. "But we have to find it," he went on. "What's it?" DCI Watson asked in a confused tone. Nighthammer ignored her question as he continued to pace frantically around the room, mumbling louder and louder to himself. "We need to find it. We need to find it before it's too late." "What are you talking about?" shouted DCI Watson, now angry with Nighthammer's antics. Nighthammer stopped his pacing and stared at her cold. "You stupid woman. Without it, we're all dead." Before she could process what he had just said, DCI Watson then saw Nighthammer run to the library fireplace mantel and reach for the brass elephant clock clown with an umbrella.
Go.
Hello. Have you or someone you love or someone you barely know been accused of murdering a world-renowned explorer? If so, I can help. Call the Peterson Law Firm. And remember, even if you did it, doesn't mean you're guilty.
With Night and Hammer's hand on the elephant clock clown with an umbrella, Mary Claire, Livingstone's long-standing loyal maid, bursts into the room.
No! Oh, my face! Oh, Sheila, I heard commotion. Are you okay?
As Watson starts to respond, Knightenhammer expectorates purple foam from his mouth.
He's been poisoned! We gotta get out of here!
They came upon Frank Zambini, clobbered with a wrench, leaning against the grand, arching banister stairway. Continuing down the stairs, Sarah Marguerite was found on the landing, a single bullet hole in her head, the pool of blood deepening the already burgundy carpet. Barty Beaufort lay bludgeoned in the foyer, a lead pipe at his side. The women quickly run to the parlor fireplace, pull the elephant clock clown with an umbrella.
Pull it! I gotta get out of here!
Are you sure she
left? Yes. Now!
They get into Livingstone's Pontiac steamroller, pull down the visor for the keys. Quiet befalls them as they drive through the December mist. Sheila notices Mary Claire's hands are trembling and reaches over to comfort her. It's been 1 year to the day since they last touched.
What just happened in there? Everybody's dead! Everybody's dead!
We need to come up with a plan.
Sheila pulls into a diner.
What can I get you two?
Two coffees black.
Time passed for what felt like days as the women sat in silence, sipping their coffees and smoking their long filtered cigarettes. Mary Claire looked deeply into Sheila's eyes, and for a moment time stood still. Memories of when they first fell in love flooded her heart. Flashback to when they first met.
Oh! I didn't know anyone was in here.
Ma'am, Oh, sorry, did you get lost? I've never seen you here before at these parties.
What's your name?
I'm Mary Claire.
I'm Sheila. It's so nice to meet you.
Hi, Sheila.
Do you have another cigarette?
I do. I'm really not supposed to be smoking in here, but maybe I'll share one with you.
I hope we run into each other again.
Oh, I think we will.
Sheila breaks the silence which was once held by Mary Claire.
Everyone is dead. I think we should go. There's no one to stop us now. I have a plane. Let's fly to the jungles and start our life. Would you go with me?
Let's do it.
Let's go.
They drive to the airport, board Sheila's plane, and take off into the night.
As they board Flight 16, headed for Jersey Shore, they were excited for their endless futures together, knowing they were going to find the Fountain of Youth, holding hands the entire flight. After Sheila and Mary Claire landed, they headed for the boardwalk, where they ran into a couple of Guidos. "Hey, boys, what's your name?" Sheila asked. "Yo, they call me Vinny. I'm into gym, tanning, and laundry. My buddy's name here is Pauly D." Pauly D pipes up and says, "I'm into GTL. Yeah, buddy." Vinny asks, "What brings you two beautiful broads to our beautiful Jersey Shore area?" Marie Claire responds tentatively, "We've heard a rumor that there's a Fountain of Youth somewhere around these parts." Pauly D says, "I'll show you my Fountain of Youth. Why don't you come over to Jenks with us, and I'll tell you all about it." The four of them sat down at Jenks, and Vinny asks, "What are you guys drinking?" Marie Claire and Sheila Watson at the same time say, "A little sniffer of brandy, please," as they continue to hold hands, as they have since they boarded the flight. Vinny and Polly say, "Cool, cool, we'll get some shots. Shots, 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 shots." Cut to a few minutes later, to a table full of empty shot glasses and two untouched sniffers of brandy. Sheila pipes up and asks, "I think it's about time you point us in the direction of the Fountain of Youth." Polly answers quickly, "It's at the Shore House." "Shore House, yeah!" Vinny confirms, "Shore House, yeah! Fist bump, push up, chapstick, yeah!" The four of them step out to the boardwalk to walk the Shore House. Sheila and Mary Claire hold hands again as they all make a quick walk to the house. As the four step into the home, the lady's hero quacks out. Sheila asks, Watson asks, "Hey, Vinny, what is that sound?" "That's the duck phone, yeah!" as Vinny points to the table. Sheila glances over and sees a phone shaped like a duck next to an elephant clock. Clown with an umbrella. Vinny and Polly lead the broad steps upstairs to where they claim their Fountain of Youth is. While walking up the stairs, the boys eye the broads up and down, talking loudly about which one they wanted. As they open the door at the top of the stairs, they see a hot tub with Stephanie Johnson's underwear floating in it, dangerously close to the filter. I didn't write this. Vinny and Polly both at the same time state awkward in a high-pitched tone. Marie Claire, holding Sheila Watson's hand, are both horrified by everything they see at this Jersey Shore house, even after they took place at the Livingston Manor. Vinny says, let's jump in." Sheila annoyingly responds, "This certainly is not the Fountain of Youth we were looking for." The grenade whistle goes off and Paul yells, "Cabs are here!" Sheila and Marie Claire hold hands even tighter. And then... Get crazy, do something
crazy. Everybody! Yo, welcome everybody to the Jersey Shore.
Yo, Polly, do you remember those broads we saw last night?
Oh, you remember those broads last night?
Do you remember their names?
Let me see. Shelly, Shauna, Slippy,
Stephanie,
Sheila,
and Marie Claire.
I remember them. They're holding hands the whole time.
Oh my, such lesbians holding hands the whole time.
Remember when you thought you could pull her though?
Yeah.
What did you say to her?
I said, "Yo, my name is Vinny and I do gym, tan, and laundry."
Gym, tan, laundry. Yeah, buddy.
Yeah, buddy.
And then I think you also said something about looking for the Fountain of Youth.
No, I didn't say nothing about the Fountain of Youth. That was Sheila and Marie Claire.
Sheila.
Ooh.
So anyways, we bring him back to the house.
No,
the
but
house.
First... We take him to Jinx. You gotta take the broad to Jinx.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
And then when we went there, what happened?
Everybody!
Then that's, I think they were said, "We're looking for the Fountain of Youth."
Fountain of Youth, and guess where the Fountain of Youth is at?
At the Shore House!
Yeah,
my buddy!
So then we walked them back very nicely down the boardwalk.
And it just so happens, right as we walked through the door, they heard a quack.
The duck phone goes off.
The duck phone.
It's right next to this little clock umbrella. It's real cute.
Was Snooki in jail again?
Probably. Snickers.
Fucking Snooki.
Snickers. So anyways, go upstairs.
Because we tell them the Fountain of Youth is upstairs.
That's right.
Yeah, buddy.
Yeah, buddy. I don't remember any more of the story.
Awkward. No, remember we go upstairs and guess what's in the hot tub?
Stephanie Johnson's underwear.
Stephanie Johnson's
just floating
underwear.
Floating there.
Oh, what was she doing in that hot tub?
And then you told them you wanted to get in the hot tub then.
For some fist bump, push up, chapstick.
Fist bump, push up, chapstick. Fist bump, push up, chapstick.
Oh, man. We were by the hot tub. And we were like,
okay.
let's get in. And COVID-19.
Chapstick. Don't worry about that.
Fist bump, push up, chapstick.
Yeah.
Okay, so we were by the hot tub.
You want to get in?
We all want to get in.
Yeah, we all want to get in, except I don't think the broads wanted to get in.
They didn't want to get in.
So then...
Sheila kept talking about the fucking Fountain of Youth.
Fountain of Youth.
I was like, I don't know about this Fountain of Youth.
They were just holding hands the whole time.
Whole
and then
time.
I had to yell, "The cabs are here."
Oh, cabs are here.
Cabs are here because They were grenades. They need to get on out of here. And
the two rekindled lovers walked away from the Jersey Shore without gaining anything at all. What a waste of time. You're telling me. They needed to return to Livingstone Manor so Sheila could retrieve the map she hid to the elusive Fountain of Youth. The map lay within the walls of Livingstone Manor in New Orleans. Sheila and Mary Claire boarded their plane to return the dark, dank hallways Dr. Livingstone called home. When they arrived, they noticed a muster of peacocks taking over the property. It was beautiful. At the gate, the lovers held hands, took a deep breath, and walked towards the looming front door. Sheila reached for the door now, but Mary Claire hid her hand away. Let me walk through first, she said, her eyes pleading with Sheila. Sheila said, Dr. Livingstone was my friend, and I don't want to put you in danger. After a long kiss, Marie Claire asked, can I please do this for you? Sheila stepped back, and Marie Claire turned the doorknob. Sheila followed Marie Claire to the great hall. Once inside, they found themselves in the presence of Dolores Finkel, the late James Nighthammer, the great Frank Zampini, Sarah Marguerite, Barty Buford, and the infamous Dr. Livingstone. When they left these individuals, they were all dead, but now they seemed not quite dead. Mary Claire stepped forward, and Ms. Finkel lunged toward her and sunk her teeth into her neck. Sheila screamed, then blacked out. The other vampires joined in the frenzy. Mary Claire was on the brink of death. Sheila woke up discombobulated. Everything was bright white. Where was Mary Claire? Is this a dream? What did she witness? Dr. Livingstone entered the room. Sheila, he said. He grabbed Sheila's warm hand with his ice-cold hand. Dear friend, how are you feeling? Is Marie Claire alive? Mary Claire alive? Her too? Not really, Dr. Livingstone replied. What do you mean? You of all people know how I feel about her. Sheila still didn't understand. I'm showing you the real Fountain Youth. The map was a decoy, he continued. I wanted to show you both. So the plan was to turn me into a vampire and tell me that this was the real Fountain of Youth? Sheila was flabbergasted. Yes, that's the short answer, Dr. Livingstone replied. I am Mrs. Finkel's maker. I need to practice on someone before you and Mary Claire became my progeny. But I have no idea who turned Jones, Frank, Sarah, and Barty. They are their own coven, he continued. How they died and then became vampires is a mystery. Do you mean to say that there is another vampire inside Livingstone Manor? God, I hope so. Before Dr. Livingstone could answer, a shadow moved in the corner of the room, and then Sheila released a silent gasp as her focus shifted to the sudden movement towards the darkened far entrance of the great hall. Mary Claire? Is that you? She desperately called out. A slight iciness wafted across her skin, and a wisp of a silhouette in the distance shocked her back into the present moment. She broke free of Dr. Livingstone's grasp and stumbled towards the vanishing form. Sheila tripped and hurtled towards an ornate flashy image behind the glass of a large display cabinet. A taxidermied rare peacock in full plumage. This peacock wasn't there on Christmas Eve, but Dr. Livingstone likely looked to redecorating with his rare worldly collectibles after the recent bloodbath and events. Trying to get her wits about her, Sheila grabbed the edge of the table next to her to pull herself up. As she presses up, something sharp stabs into her hand. Once standing, she sees one of Dolores' daggers was on top of the table and has sliced her hand. While staring at the blood beginning to pool on her hand. The large peacock's head swings in her direction. She looks up only to make direct eye contact with the peacock. In disbelief, she watches the peacock transform, growing dramatically in size and shifting into human form. What she had taken for a taxidermy decorative piece was now a striking 6-foot Indian glamazon in full peacock regalia, including a feathered headdress, sequined gown, and plumaged floor-length cape. So this might be a little problematic. Is that blood I smell? Who brought me a late Christmas gift? Said Rue Peacock, drag queen of the undead. Oh, look. Oh, honey, look. Oh, all right. Pause. Oh, honey, you look startled, Rue Peacock said to Sheila. I've watched you since your first visit, and I've been hidden in my animal-feathered form. I'm the queen of these covers. I arrived, let my freak feathers fly at Mardi Gras in 1834, spending every penny I had on my train ticket and headdress. I followed the wrong handsome man's invitation to a dark corner, left for dead and undead in this case. For a century I found my way, but craved a family, which I've decided to make. He waves his arms around the room on these final words. Sheila hears this story being told, but can't stop staring at Marie Claire, or is it Mary Claire, and letting the truth sink in. The love of her life is now a vampire. All eyes are on her, as Dr. Livingston says, now it's your turn. Marie Claire rushes in front of her, says, stop, I have a better idea. As a well-respected detective, Sheila can keep her job and her life while keeping the suspicion away from this house by always covering up those we kill. The doorbell rings, followed by, yo, Marie Claire and Sheila, it's your boys. The smell of Vinnie and Polly's cologne enters the room before they do. They enter the scene looking at Rue Peacock and say, man, are you rich? Rue Peacock says, honey, if you've been alive and in your prime 200 years you're still poor, just go run a bath of holy water because there's no hope for you. Using telepathy, Rue Peacock makes the Jersey Boys into his familiars, and they become eunuchs so they never are able to reproduce. 45 years later, Christmas Eve, 1987. Really? Alright. Sheila's Ford Taurus pulls up to the manor and slowly steps out of the car with the use of her cane. Marie Claire rushes to her side. Sheila comes back every Christmas to spend the holidays with her chosen double coven undead family. How strange to view this couple now. A golden girl and her ageless undead love. After an evening of blood-orange cocktails and Christmas music, the bronze elephant antique clock strikes midnight. Sheila is sleeping on the recliner as she passed out hours ago. 8 p.m. has been her typical bedtime since turning 80 a few years ago, and Rue Peacock pulls down the clown holding the umbrella, and the steel barrier shuts the house in. The vamps retire to their lair and tuck themselves in their coffin, while Vinny and Polly shut their lids and retire to their separate quarters, where they snuggle into their tanning beds.
Action.
Oh, I see Dawn's rosy fingers tickling my eyes. That means it's time for the end. Merry Christmas, everyone.